Full Bloom interview with producer Ric Browde. You can listen to more interviews with Ric at fullandbloom.com. Click the links in the description. One thing that I want to make sure that we cover is you mentioned that you had worked with Michael Schenker. Now, you can't just be throwing his name out there and then not tell me about it. What did you work with him on?
I did an aborted album in 1983, right after the first Victory album.
So he's like a train wreck at this point.
He was more than a train wreck. David Krebs, I was managed by David Krebs. David called me and he said, I did Victory, and he said, I want you to go to England with Michael, a bass player by the name of Dennis Feldman, and a singer named Ray Kennedy, and a drummer named Ted McKenna. And I go over to England, and Michael is beyond fucked up. I mean, just ridiculous. And we did three songs in Trident Studios, first at the Roundhouse Studios and then at Trident. And Ray Kennedy was a total drug addict and was drug dealing. And he and Ted were selling equipment out the, like they'd sell a guitar amp for drug money and things like that. And Ray was schizophrenic and so fucked up on coke. And Michael was in a really bad coke thing. And I spoke pretty fluent German. And so one night, Michael comes up and he goes, I don't have any cocaine. I'm going, oh, you know, tough shit, basically. And he goes, I'm going to call David Krebs, who is in New York. And he goes to David, if you don't get me cocaine tonight, and he gave him, I think, a 3 or 4 hour time limit, I'm going to burn my house down. And I go, Michael, I was like, you know, I wasn't sure how good Michael's English was, and it actually was quite good. But I was like, I talked to him in German, and I was like, Michael, don't you think it'd be a better threat that he burned down David's house than your house? And he goes, no, he wouldn't. That would be dishonorable. But it's like, I mean, he won't take me seriously. He won't respect me if I burn his house down. Okay. Drunken ramblings, coke ramblings. I think nothing of it. I, you know, go back to my hotel. And about 12:30 at night, my phone rings, and it's the Oxford fire marshal going, we have Michael Schenker here in custody. He has just burned his house with his wife and kid in it. They're fine. Don't worry. And so he burned his own house down.
What the fuck? Did he really?
And I quit. I immediately quit and went back. And then David made me try and do the album. That's when I ran into Werman, actually, I think at Cherokee. I was into Cherokee with Ray Kennedy, who was like totally undrugged out. And that's where Werman and I had this really cool discussion. And then about 3 or 4 months later, they sent Michael to work with Fran Cosmo, who had been in the band Orion the Hunter with Barry Goudreau from Boston. And they went to Syracuse, and he was staying in a Holiday Inn. And it got, and Krebs got the same phone call. You need to get me cocaine or I will kill myself. And this time Michael threw all his guitars, and this is before video cameras, things like that, into the, I'm going to kill myself and burn everything. So instead what he did was, he didn't get the cocaine. He pulled the toilet off the bathroom of his hotel room, flooding out the entire place. Threw all his guitars and video camera and all his possessions in the swimming pool. The Holiday Inn, you know, charged him for having to empty the swimming pool, you know, and clean everything. And there was like, I think it was like $15,000 worth of damage. But he lost all his guitars and everything. Michael was really crazy in those days. But, you know, there's something about him. He was really difficult to work with. He really was, because, you know, he was just always testing you as to whether you were paying attention. Like, he'd mess up deliberately and to make sure that you caught it. I could trust you again. And what's funny is every time I see him, he's incredibly pleasant. And
oh, he got his shit together. And he's, like, consistent where he is working. And he looks great. I mean, he looks healthy, oddly enough.
Yeah, I mean, he's a very, I mean, the Schenker family, and there's a sister who's more fucked up than he was, Barbara, who was in a band called Viva, and really nice person as well. And, you know, they came from a weird situation. Their father ran away and was in the railroad and just disappeared one day. And, you know, they had a tough life. And Rudolph started out as a car thief to finance Scorpions. Michael was crazy. He did way too much cocaine and drank way, way, way too much. But he was clearly talented, incredibly good guitar player.
Oh, amazing.
Even when he was fucked up.
Yeah.
But had the misfortune of choosing musicians that did not compliment him, you know, after UFO. They never, I mean, the best he had was Robin McCauley and afterwards, but just never had the chance to escape all the problems that he did. He always kept with people who were equally destructive in his heyday. And then he was too, you know, you age out and you don't have that big an audience. I mean, you can play the He Used to Be Somebody tours and, you know, make a bare living. And I'm sure that's what he's doing. But last I heard was he was in Arizona doing things. And, but he's, you know, a phenomenally talented guy. No doubt about it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I interviewed Billy Sheehan years ago, and Billy was in briefly in like the tail end of UFO and said that Billy was like, he was a hero of mine, and as it was UFO, and he said, so it was heartbreaking, but he went into a session and Michael stunk, hadn't bathed for weeks, and he had to like tune his guitar because he was so fucked up. Michael couldn't tune his own instrument.
He was paralytic at times, but when he played, he could play. We did three songs, and one of them was really good, actually. And Ray Kennedy had been a very successful songwriter.
Why does that name sound familiar? What else was, did he do other bands?
He wrote Sail on Sailor for the Beach Boys. He recently died. Trying to think what else. He was in a band with Barry Goldberg, and I can't remember what it was. It was like supposed to be one of these super group songwriters, but he's gotten one of the hugest deals in Atlantic, but he fucked it up so they never even released the album because he was so drugged out. It was like a huge deal. And David Krebs always thought he was a big talent. I think he was a Jesus Christ Superstar, too.
Oh, wow. Like, not the movie.
I think he was. Not the movie, but the Broadway show. It's been so long, many brain cells left, but yeah, it's not somebody I often think about, but it was just really weird. Weirdest situation I'd ever been in, having a guy burn his own house down.
How great that you were sober through that whole, especially the 80s, where everybody was a wreck.
Yeah, I mean, I was the only straight guy. And that's why, I mean, David Krebs wanted me to join Aerosmith to try and keep Steve and Tyler straight. You know, be the keyboard player off the stage. You know, and I was like, one meeting later, meeting Steve, and I was like, nope, not going to happen. You know, but, you know, it was just, yeah. You know, I never indulged in my reputation was as such, and they used to put me always with junkies because of that. You know, I'd always end up with these junkies, you know, like the Wildhearts and things like that. And
Ginger's still Ginger. Kind of, he has moments where he gets suicidal. I follow him on Twitter, and
I tried to sign him, and actually did sign him, and brought him to East West Records when I had my little label at ATCO, you know, that they were going to give me. So Ginger is one of the most incredibly talented guys, but he's, the paranoia and drugs have gotten in the way. But from what I understand, he's gotten his life together quite a bit, and though he's still depressed as hell half the time, but he did some brilliant records. I mean, probably my favorite rock band of the early 90s or mid 90s, Fishing for Luckies is one of my favorite records, and the Silver Ginger album that he did. But it's funny, we ran into each other, but he called me up one day a few years ago and went out with him and the guy who produced Guns N' Roses' first album, Mike Clink, and went to this party together and had the most fascinating good time. I really, really respect Mike Clink. And then I went and saw him in Italy a couple of years ago. I was over in Padova in Italy, and I was doing something for Italian TV, I think, over there. And Ginger was there, and we had just spent a few hours together and gone out a couple of times. And, you know, we get along great now. He's just incredibly talented, but not, you know, he's been his own worst enemy his entire life. But when he turns stuff out, I mean, he'll come out with these amazing songs. And he's somebody who I will always, to the day he dies or I die, whichever comes first, will always check out whatever he does and hope that I find something really good. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. But I've listened to very, very, very little rock and roll. I mean, I couldn't name you anybody out there, but if I see Ginger does something, I will check it out.